You've all had lunch. I hope you had a nice lunch. We're going to start with this afternoon session. I know that after lunch, sometimes we can be a bit sleepy. So I'm going to try to make this as interesting as possible. First of all, I'm going to introduce myself. And my name is Caridad Canales. I work for UNESCAP. I want to know, and please lift your hands, who knows who or what UNESCAP is? Anyone knows? Have any of you heard about these institutions? Any ideas? No. Okay, that's okay. It's the United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. So I work for the office or the arm of the United Nations Secretariat that deals with the social and economic issues in Asia and the Pacific. And today I'm going to talk to you about the implementation of the 2030 Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals. Okay, question number two. Lift your hand if you have heard about the 2030 Agenda. In the news, in the radio, at school, in university, any of the papers that you've read? No. Okay. That's good, because I'm going to tell you about it. So after this, you will have learned something new. And what about the Sustainable Development Goals? Have you heard about them? Yes. Okay. That's fantastic. So let me tell you, if you have heard about the Sustainable Development Goals, you have heard and you know about the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. So there you go. You do know about it. So let me start by saying that the 2030 Agenda is the follow-up or the continuation of the Millennium Development Goals. Have you heard about those before?
No.
No, yes. It's a bit of a mix. Okay, the Millennium Development Goals, as their name, as you can hear by their name, they were these goals that were accepted, and there were your governments, our governments of the world, they approved and they decided to have a set of goals in year 2000. And they said by 2015 we want to tackle a number of issues, regarding poverty, regarding education, regarding health, regarding the environment, regarding gender, etc., etc. After 15 years of hard work of our governments, they realized that they have achieved some of these goals, but others have not been achieved. So they decided that there was the need to keep on working on these issues. And here comes the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. In 2015, our government representatives got together in the UN headquarters in New York, in September, during the General Assembly, and they decided that they wanted to do something about those pressing issues that, that are related to a better life for everyone, for each one of us. And they decided to approve the 2030 Agenda and the Sustainable Development Goals. Over the next 15 years, with these new goals, that universally apply to all. Every country approved these goals, and they apply whether they're rich or poor, high income, middle income, low income. All of the countries in the world approved them. And they will mobilize efforts to end all forms of poverty, fight inequalities, and tackle climate change while ensuring that no one is left behind. There was obviously a good foundation that was left by the Millennium Development Goals. So this means that the goals that we're working on now, and I say we because all of you will at some point, I'm sure will be contributing towards the achievement of this, we're not starting from zero. There was a lot of work that was done in the previous era of the Millennium Development Goals. So We are just carrying on the work that has been done, and the 2030 agenda imposes a new and more ambitious approach. The new goals are unique in that they call action by all countries, as I just said, to promote prosperity while protecting the planet. They recognize that ending poverty must go hand in hand with strategies that build economy and address a range of social needs, including education, health, social protection, and job opportunities while tackling climate change and environmental protection. So, as you can see, I've just mentioned like 10 different issues. Actually, we have 17 goals, and I'm gonna go back just to show you. The 17 goals relate to poverty, to hunger, to good health and well-being, to the quality of education, to gender, to water and sanitation, to energy, to decent work and economic growth, to industry innovation, to reducing inequalities, to sustainable cities and communities, to responsible consumption and production, to climate change, life below water, life on land, peace and justice, and partnerships for the goals. So we're trying to include absolutely everything in these 17 goals. So while these SDGs are not legally binding, what does that mean? That our countries, or there is no one that will go and say, oh, why didn't you achieve this goal? Or why are you not working towards achieving these 17 goals? That's not how the UN works. The UN works in a way in which each of our governments accept willingly to work towards these goals. And governments are expected to take ownership and establish national frameworks for the achievement of these 17 goals. Countries have the primary responsibility for follow-up and review of the progress made in the implementation in the goals, which will require quality, accessible, and timely data collection. Regional follow-up and review will be based on national level analysis and contribute to follow-up and review at the global level. What does that mean? That means that each one of our countries is going to be responsible to measure if we're going in the right direction, if we need to put more effort, or if we need help, for example. But what does that mean in the context of Asia Pacific? So we've seen, or I've told you, that this agenda is very ambitious. And I don't know if anyone so the first bullet in this slide. What do you think about that? By 2030, it aims the agenda to end poverty and hunger everywhere. So that gives us less than 15 years now, right? It's very ambitious. It's a lot of work. So we have a lot to do, and seeing you here is one of the reasons I think that it becomes really important, because you're talking or you're listening or you're discussing topics as climate change, as green economy, social business, innovation, and all of those things are going to be needed in order to achieve these goals. So you guys are very important in the work that is going to be needed to achieve the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And why is your work and your participation going to be very important and very relevant? Because not only have our countries set a very ambitious goal for themselves, but the context in which that ambitious goal has been set is also very challenging. So, poverty rates have gone from 52% to in 1990 to 15% in 2012. We have done a lot in the region. The latest poverty rates are below 1% in countries like Thailand, like Iran, like Kazakhstan, like Mongolia, like Russia and Turkey. And some countries have had remarkable changes. For example, Cambodia, China, Indonesia, Kyrgyzstan, Pakistan and Vietnam have poverty rates are now in between 40 or 50 percent points lower than in the 1990s. So you might think, wow, all of this is fantastic, but we still have a lot to do, especially if we want to eradicate poverty in all its forms and if we want to end hunger. So we don't want to leave anyone behind. Our countries have agreed that we have to end poverty. Not one single person living under $190 per day in the world. Governments have shown leadership and commitment to share development outcomes. Civil society is also on board and has also supported this great and this ambitious agenda. We see that at least 21 countries in the Asia-Pacific region have increased social protection spending as a share of total government expenditure over the past two decades. And we have examples like Thailand and China where they have also started working, knowingly or not, on issues like this. So implementation has started and has moved faster than the Millennium Development Goals. Why has this happened? The process to adopt and to agree on all these issues was a very participative process. All the countries were involved. People were asked what they were worried about. They were asked to be part of the conversation. And that has made an important difference with the Millennium Development Goals, because there is a sense of ownership. And the countries across the world, they are taking that forward. And we see examples in countries in which they have already started including international plans, for example, how to work on SDGs. We have examples, for example, where countries have created specific dedicated ministries like Sri Lanka. We have institutional strengthening and coordination. We have adaptation of SDGs to the national context. And we have countries which are integrating SDGs into their national development plan and policies. So this is a great way forward, because if our countries and our governments do not have a way to work with this, if they don't have a plan on how to develop and how to move forward, it is going to be very difficult, first of all, to know how to do things, and secondly, it is going to be very difficult to see where we're going, if we're going in the right direction, or if we need to do something different, if we need to take another path. So the fact that some of our countries in the region are already adjusting their national plans, their laws, their ministries even, it gives a bit more strength to the way we approach each one of these Sustainable Development Goals. But achieving these Sustainable Development Goals is not going to be business as usual. It's going to require fundamental transformations in societies, and it's going to require a holistic and integrative view. So we cannot, I think, one of the transformations that this the 2030 agenda is going to make us go into is the way we think. It's a very integrative agenda. All of the Sustainable Development Goals relate to each other. And if you have time afterwards, and if you want to look at the Sustainable Development Goals, please do go ahead and look at them and see what do they mean, what are the targets, what are the objectives. I think it's a very interesting exercise, and it will make you think, how are we going to do every, from all the, each one of the goals, we have different targets as well. So it's not, we're not only talking about 17 goals, but we're talking around 160 targets in total. So as you can see, it's a lot of work. And that's why we're going to need efforts from every single actor and stakeholder in society. We're going to need a transformative view. And we're going to need to go beyond finance. We're going to need means of implementation that are actually helping us achieve these goals. What is the context of the region? So we already have a set of very ambitious goals, and we have to implement them in our region. But it's a very dynamic region, and it's a region that it's been characterized, or that's been transformed by megatrends, by urbanization, by demographic change, by connectivity, and by regional integration and trade. So we're seeing changes that are going to have a deep and profound influence on how we live, where we live, on how we move, on how we communicate with each other, how our societies communicate with other societies, how we are able to get a product from another country. So these megatrends, such as the ones that you can see there, are referring to the expanding infrastructure that allows people across the region to connect, whether via roadways or the internet. And these trends are shaping our societies and our relationships with each other, and with the natural environment as well, via our lifestyles and consumption and production patterns. That is also changing as well. 10 years ago, our consumption patterns were very different to the consumption patterns that we have now. Now, we're seeing that we eat more meat, for example. What does that mean? What does that mean for the environment? What does that mean for our resources? What does that mean for trade? These are the questions that we need to have in mind, and these are the megatrends that we need to have as a background. This is our scenario in which we, as people working on development, have to bear in mind. This slide shows how dramatically these megatrends are impacting at the region. We are becoming predominantly urban, and reliance on intra-regional trade is increasing. The demand for natural resources is high and growing exponentially. So now we require more and better water. Now we require more and better services. Internet, we want internet everywhere. We want Wi-Fi everywhere. We want to be connected all the time through Facebook, through our mobile phones. And we need, we want to have everything accessible. So all of those things have great impact on, as I said, on resources, on trade, on our lifestyles. But another very unique characteristic in our region is the fact that there are a lot of inequalities. And this is a very, very, I would say this is one of the most important elements of the 2030 agenda. We don't want to end poverty only, but we want to also end with inequalities. And at the rate that we are going at the moment, our societies and our countries are becoming more and more unequal. That means that the poorest of the poor are becoming even more poor. And that means that the people who have more are getting more and more rich. And that, in a society, doesn't work well. Because we're gonna end up with two extremes in which people have absolutely nothing and people having absolutely everything. And what we want as countries is to have people that can access services, that can have a good and decent life. And by this, and I think this is a very important point that we need to distinguish, we don't want to make everyone rich. We cannot. I wish we could, but we can't, unfortunately, because otherwise we would need probably 50 or 100 planets. We cannot be extremely rich, but we can have a good, decent life with access to good services, to good social healthcare, to good education, to a good job that we enjoy, to being safe, to have a good environment, free of pollution. That's the kind of life that we want for everyone. So inequality is also not a one-sided concept. It's multidimensional. What does that mean? It means that there are inequalities of outcomes, there are inequalities of opportunities. Some might have a lot of opportunities, and therefore they're very well set in life. Some people, because of where they were born, they might have less opportunities, and that sometimes marks their life. And you might think that's not fair. Exactly, it's not fair. It would be ideal if we all would have the same opportunities, the same level or playing field. And that's what we want. We want for everyone to have the same good opportunities, to give them a good start. So, talking about individual countries, while income inequality has declined, so I've just told you we've reduced poverty by 50 percentage points in some countries. But income inequality has declined since the early 1990s in some countries, the share of total income received by the poorest quintile in 11 of 17 countries of which Redeta was available has decreased. So I was telling you, the poorest of the poor are receiving less and are becoming even more poor. There is notable decrease in inequality in China, Indonesia, and Laos, for example. There are also good examples. Nearly 3 out of 4 people in Asia Pacific are living in countries where income inequality has increased or remained stagnant over the last 15 years. So we have been able to reduce poverty, but we haven't been good enough at reducing inequalities. And this is where we need young, innovative people like you. This is where we need you to be thinking about how can we make these income inequalities smaller and smaller. We need to think out of the box because we're not in a business as usual world anymore. Technology has a very important play to role, has a very important role to play. And seeing from the topics that you have been discussing throughout the week, I think that's where you can play a role. That's where you can have a way of thinking different. So the 2030 agenda represents a new social contract between governments, leaders, and people, between all of us. The strength of the social contract shapes the relationships and levels of accountability between governments and people, between governments and the private sector, between groups of people, and between different kinds of stakeholders and society. The strength of the social contract also influences the distribution and allocation of benefits of economic growth and the burdens of the negative externalities of growth, such as the loss of social capital, pollution, or loss of food security. Markets influence the social contract by changing access to resources, natural resources, information, technical support as examples, as well as access to basic goods and services such as health and education. So what the 2030 agenda is proposing is having these, is leveling the playing field, is trying to bring everyone to the same level so we can have the same beginning and we can have, as I said before, the same kind of opportunities and the same responsibilities as well, which is also an important word because we want to have access, but we also need to be aware of the responsibilities that convey this wanting of equal opportunities for everyone. The 2030 agenda also talks about means of implementation. So it gives us four very clear ways of implementing the Sustainable Development Goals. And we talk about trade, capacity building, technology, and finance. And these four elements are the four elements that are highlighted as those that are going to be enabling, that are going to provide the elements for the governments in our region, for our countries, to be able to convey and to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. So, for example, at the domestic level, we can talk about reform and fiscal policy. We can talk about incentives. At the regional and global level, we can talk about policy coherence, about trade access. And here, ESCAP, as a United Nations arm in the region, can play an important role. It can facilitate South-South cooperation. It can nudge investments in sectors that are crucial to SDGs achievements. And it can forge interlinkages among the various means of implementation. So how many of you have heard about South-South cooperation? What do you think it means? When we talk about South-South cooperation, we talk about countries in the global South, as they call it, countries who are developing to help each other because they're in the same level, they are going through the same. So through the same challenges, through the same burdens, I would say, to the same, they're going through the same problems, growing problems, some would say. And there is a great benefit in sharing these experiences because it's not always good to receive everything from those or those countries that are already developed. They've done their thing, they have figured out how to have a stable society, societies that can have opportunities. But some of our countries are still in that path. And South-South cooperation, which is highly promoted in the UN, is a very good way of sharing experiences, lessons learned, what has worked and what hasn't. And I think you, all of you coming from different backgrounds, from different countries, some similar in a social economic context, is a great opportunity. You are doing South-South cooperation at the moment. So that's what we need, and we need more of it. UNESCAP has also received a very important mandate from each one of your countries, from each one of the 53 member countries of in the region. And this mandate is to promote the balanced integration of three dimensions of sustainable development, to support the process to define a regional roadmap, to strengthen support to implementation, and to provide capacity building opportunities. So you see here that the resolution adopted by the Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific, ESCAP, was adopted recently, just last year, 2016, and committed to the effective implementation of the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development in Asia and the Pacific. So what this is doing basically is taking from the global level, bringing it to the region, and trying to